Well, thanks everyone for coming to our Farmer Time National Ag Day presentations, and it's all very exciting today. We've got a great lineup of producers today, and first up, we have Renee Anderson, who works for Cotton Australia, and is here to talk about the wonderful world of cotton. And we also have Jenny Hughes here from Cotton Australia as well. So we're bound to have a fantastic discussion this morning. So I'll hand it all over to Renee. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm really excited to be able to join you today on National Ag Day. My name's Renee Anderson, and I am a farmer in Central Queensland, Australia. And I also work a day a week for Cotton Australia as the regional manager. So my farm here, we're a family farm. I have a husband and two boys, and we have two farms. We run 500 hectares under irrigation if there's water available in a scheme. We're currently going into a summer season with no irrigation, and it's the first time since we've been on the farm that we won't have a summer crop, which is a little bit sad. So we're really looking forward to some rainfall. So we've just finished harvesting some winter crops. So I had some wheat and chickpeas that did exceptionally well. It's probably one of the better winter crop seasons that we've had in a really long time. So here on this place, the last few years have been very reduced allocations on the farm. Last season was 16% under irrigation. And the year before that was around 20%, and the year before that around 25%. So as a farmer in this particular valley, it's really important for good monsoonal rainfalls to come through to help us. So we've got a very large irrigation dam that feeds this whole entire valley. We've got around 40 to 60 irrigators that grow cotton, and I'm one of those irrigators. We also have a really diverse range of different crops here in this valley. So some of the things that we do grow here, apart from cotton, chickpeas, wheat, popcorn, mung beans, and we have grown maize and sorghum in other years as well. So a little bit about my role too with Cotton Australia. As the regional manager, so my role is to deliver community education. So I go and visit the schools and I chat to community groups. We host the photography club. A few weeks ago, we had some of our councillors. We took them on a farm tour, got to show them around the dam and just really engage with people who have never been exposed to agriculture or farming before. I find it a really rewarding job working with growers as well. So we try and ensure that they're up to date with the best practices. And one of my other roles is helping growers through an environmental management system program in the cotton industry called MyBMP. And it's our stewardship program to ensure that we are doing the very best that we can with the water that we have, with the soil that we have, and the natural landscapes on our farm. So ensuring that we provide habitats for birds, bats, and bees, that we maintain the trees that we have on our farm, and if we're near rivers or creek systems, that we're protecting that riparian zone and those waterways. Because for us on farm, the soil and the water are the two most important things that we have. Without them, we can't grow the crops that we do. I have a little bit of a slide that I've done a little bit of a discussion topic on irrigation and why do we irrigate certain crops. So I'll just go through that with you. I'll see if I can get this to work.
I can learn to understand you much better if I can get familiar with the way you talk.
Oops.
I need your permission to help.
Sorry, I don't know what that is. I don't know what just happened. Then I bumped a button. Share screen. All I accidentally bumped the voice activation on my computer. So here I've got some images. Can everyone see those? Thumbs up, Jenny. Yep, excellent. So this is the chickpeas under irrigation. And I'm not sure if you have ever had chickpeas. They're very, very popular in India. But here in Australia, you've probably had them as a dip in hummus. It's one of the most popular dips when you go to a barbecue. They're very high protein and they're a legume crop, which is really important too. So a legume crop means that the plant's roots are able to nodulate and source nitrogen from the air. So that reduces the amount of fertilizer that I need to put into the ground to provide nutrients to that plant. This is really important because it's reducing the amount of emissions that we could potentially put into the air through the use of synthetic fertilizers. So they're a really great rotation crop with the other crops that we do grow. So why do we irrigate crops? As I was mentioning before, sometimes we don't always get rainfall at the right time to grow the food and fiber crops that we do on farm. So you can see here in my picture, there's a really big dry patch and there was quite a few in the crop this year because we had very minimal rainfall, I think around 16 millimetres. So we went into that we started that season with really dry conditions. So that whole entire field needed to be irrigated. And the water helps with the germination after you plant the seed. So I'm not sure if you're aware what germination is. So when you plant the seed, that water and the soil contact helps the plant to sprout and grow. I've just got a little video here. I'll see if I can run this. So we have a little Polaris buggy here on the farm.
5, 6, 7, 8.
And I did a little tour around the chickpea field. So I'm not sure if you noticed, but there was a lot of black pipes in the top of those fields. So they're called irrigation siphons. And at the top of the field, we have a head ditch and each of those pipes have to be started by hand. So here on farm, we've got a full-time worker that helps out with Brad to start all of those siphons. It gets done twice a day. So it's quite a busy time of the year when you are irrigating. It takes around an hour or two, up to 2.5 hours if it's a really long shift change to start all of those irrigation pipes. And they do it in around a 12-hour shift. So they get up quite early in the morning. So they're starting irrigation around 5 o'clock, come home for breakfast at 7:30, 8 o'clock, and then work during the day and they'll do the same thing again in the afternoon. So plants need water to keep them cool. Evapotranspiration process is where the plants they're sucking the nutrients up through the soil, and to keep them cool, they'll exude that water through the leaves, which keeps that evaporation process keeps them cool. This here is Eli the farm dog. He is a little sausage cross beagle. He's out checking the chickpeas with me. So one of the things that we do have to do as well, and I have a full-time agronomist now, it used to be one of my roles prior to being full-time here on the farm, was checking crops for insects, pests and diseases. And that's a really important part of what we do here on farm. Some crops are very susceptible to pests and diseases. This particular variety of chickpeas is quite resistant. So we didn't have any issues with diseases, and we had one or two insect sprays for Heliophis caterpillar, which used to be a really big problem in the cotton industry. We now grow genetically engineered varieties that are resistant to that main particular caterpillar that caused quite a lot of issues previously. A very common question is, why do we use so much water? So the determining factor for water use in different crops will change and vary every single season, because there's a couple of things that will change why plants need the amount of water that they do. So if you grow a winter crop, it will obviously use a lot less water because temperatures are lower. Quite often there's a lot less humidity, so the plants aren't struggling for that thirstiness. The other thing is obviously rainfall. So if you have a reduced rainfall year, like we have had in the last few years with the El Nino, you will need to put on a little bit more water than, say, in a wet year that hopefully is coming this year with La Nina. So that will change every single year. The other really important things is whether they're flowering and podding or fruiting, which is really peak period of time for those particular crop growth periods. So you can imagine if you've got strawberries or cherries, avocados, when they're ripening, they need quite a lot of water to help the plant transpire and keep that plant cool, because they're putting a lot of energy into that growth period. So here's some chickpea flowers. They're quite a beautiful little plant. They're quite short. They exude an acid. So when you walk through them, you'll come out and you get quite wet. And I've got a little photo of me. Here's a little video. So I love doing TikToks. I find them really quite educational. Oops, there's someone sitting in the waiting room.
How you like that? You don't like that, da 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 like that.
So chickpeas are a really short season crop too. So as I was walking through, my jeans and my boots were getting covered in the acid. And it's a naturally built-in protection system that the chickpeas have to stop caterpillars or other insects such as aphids and weevils attacking them. Unfortunately, the Heliothus caterpillar love the flavour. It's a little bit like salt and vinegar chips, so they munch on them quite readily. So most of Australia grow chickpeas, most of New South Wales, down through Victoria, don't use irrigation on chickpeas. I'm here in the northern part of central Queensland, so it's often quite dry during winter, whereas the southern valleys will often have rainfall. So for us, that being able to irrigate those crops provides a really secure production. And it's only a much shortened or reduced irrigation rather than a full season crop, because they are quite susceptible to getting waterlogging, which is basically if you're in a pool and you've been in there all day and you get quite wrinkly in your skin. So same thing sort of happens with their roots, and they're unable to gather the nutrients up from the soil. So you can see here, these are the roots on the chickpeas, and I was talking about earlier, they're a legume crop. So these are nodules. Those nodules allow the plant to extract nitrogen from the air, which is a form of their food. So it's nutrient from the air, which is a really important part for reducing emissions here on farm. So there's the irrigation siphons. So during cotton season, we generally have around six to eight, depending on how warm the season is. So each of those are started from a head ditch, which is the water in the channel behind, that looks like Carl, my full-time employee there. And they will run for a shift of around 8 hours down that paddock. So it's really important to monitor soil moisture. You don't want waterlogged plants, and if they're too dry, they won't put on enough fruit to be productive yield. So the monitoring of the water, forecasting, watching the Bureau of Meteorology to look at those forecasts are really, really important. That's a better photo. So can you see the little droplets there on the outside of the chickpeas? So that's oxalic and malic acid that that plant is exuding as a bit of a protection to keep it cool and keep those insects away. Now, cotton. This is my favourite plant in the whole world. And I've been lucky enough to be working in the cotton industry for a really long time. So I started out in 96, and I was working for the Department of Agriculture in the entomology department. And if you don't know what entomology is, it's the study of insects. Farmers have a love-hate relationship with insects. I find them very fascinating. So we have good pests and we have bad pests. And in the 96 and 97, I was working on a research project with our entomologist here in Central Queensland, looking at how genetically engineered cotton would fit within our environment here. Because we're further to the north and we have a higher risk of more pest insects, the technology needed to be protected so that it would last a really long time in our industry. So we had to come up with ways that we would be able to grow genetically engineered cotton for a really long time. And we came up with some really good strategies on using integrated pest management, which is a lot of tools in the toolbox to use beneficial insects, trap cropping. So adding other crops within the cotton on the farm in different fields to mix insects together to reduce the load of resistance that may happen on that farm. After I was with the entomology department for a few years and that research project finished, I was doing agronomy for the next sort of 15 to 20 years, and as well as environmental auditing. So that was checking other people's farms for insects, pests and diseases. Farm hygiene plays a really big role on our farms. So we make sure that we keep them extremely clean of and free of weeds. And that reduces the risk of high pest pressure on the farm and also the spread of diseases, because some insects can carry plant diseases as they move around with storms. So why do I love cotton too? As you can see, it's a natural fibre. So on that plant, the fibre is as it is. So it takes minimal processing post-farm gate to turn it into something that's usable and wearable, unlike many other fibres. So the only other two that are similar is the wool and cotton. So many of the other fibres that are out there need a little bit more processing. If they're a bast fibre, such as linen from the flax plant or hemp from the hemp plant, it requires a couple of extra processes to get them to a usable fibre. So basically, we send our cotton away and it gets brushed and combed clean and spun into yarn. So you can see here, I've got some soil moisture probes, and the dogs there are watching on the irrigation very closely. Soil moisture monitoring is probably one of the most important things that we do on farm, because water is extremely expensive and it's a very precious resource everywhere across Australia. And as climate change impacts areas, we'll see a lot more longer, drier periods. So being able to monitor exactly what our plants use, when they need the water and how much water they require, ag technology has become a really big player to help us guide those decision-making tools. So I've also got canopy sensors this year, which will aid those decisions. So basically, we have ag technology that's measuring the canopy to tell us how hot it is. It is talking to the computer, as well as measuring how much moisture is in the soil. It's then connecting with the Bureau of Meteorology, looking at forecasts to really help guide those decisions. This is my last little one. So this is the water coming onto the farm. And it's almost like a little spa. It's quite soothing. And during summer, when it's really, really hot at the end of the day, it's lovely to just go and sit around there and cool down. Thank you. So the crops will vary every year depending on market price, water availability, and you know, whether there's someone that's willing to buy our product. So this year, as I mentioned earlier, there won't be any summer crops growing here unless it rains in the next few weeks. The cotton season is much more extended currently. So we have new technology with 3-gene cotton. So there's 3 pest resistant genes that have been built into the crop. So we now have the option to plant from the 1st of August right through to the 31st of December. So if I do get some rain in the next couple of weeks, we may be able to put some in towards the end of the year. And that crop will be harvested the following year around May or June. In a normal season, we would plant at the start of August or the middle of August, and then it's generally harvested in February. Our old season used to be planted in September and then harvested end of February and March. And it became quite a risky scenario because that sort of ties up with monsoonal season here in central Queensland. So generally every time we brought the harvesters out, it would rain, which is very unfortunate and can impact on yield. I think that's about it. I've done lots of talking and I'd love to hear some questions if anyone has some questions.
If anyone has any questions, if they want to write them in the chat area.
Renee, I wouldn't mind knowing a bit more about how you connect with community. So how far you are from town.
Yep, sure.
And some of the difficulties you come across, you know, living rurally.
As you saw earlier, some of the difficulties are technology and telecommunications. We do have quite a lot of black spots out here and telecommunication dropouts. So sometimes it's quite hard to get people on phone or doing internet banking when everything has moved very quickly in terms of technology and the telecommunications hasn't sort of kept up with a lot of those changes. So that has been quite difficult. The new moisture probes have changed the way they're doing it. So it's no longer on the 4G network. It's sort of using short, sharp bursts of data and sends it across on an older network, which requires less reception, which is quite good. I do a lot in the community too, and most of the growers here in this valley do as well. I'm only 5Ks from town, so I'm very lucky. So I sort of live, I have the best of both worlds. I live on a farm and I'm surrounded by a beautiful environment, beautiful sunsets, and can travel 5Ks into town, catch up with friends and have a coffee each morning. And so being part of the community is very important for farmers because we need the support of those around us. So volunteering and being quite social is a really big part of what I do every day. School talks are great. I love visiting the schools, the kindies. I've done a lot of work with the university. We now have an ag science degree here in town, which is really great. So that only came in about 3 or 4 years ago. So interacting with those students has been really valuable for me because you get a much better perspective of some of the views from younger people that are coming through in ag, and it helps keep in touch with what their values are and what they feel is important for farming and agriculture going into the future.
Fantastic. Renee, can I ask you to stop sharing your screen? Just
yes,
that'd be great. And we have some really good questions in the chat area. I'm not sure if you can see those. A question from Leonie: are there any legal requirements, procedures when planting GM cotton?
We have lots of very strict rules around growing genetically engineered crops here in Australia, and we don't actually have very many of them. So there's cotton, canola and safflower. So there's only the three. We did have a blue flower. I'm not sure that that's grown anymore. So we have what's called a technology user agreement. There is very, very strict rules around growing it. And in my valley, we have to grow a trap crop. And here I grow pigeon pea. And that's part of that resistance management plan to ensure that the built-in genes last for a really long time. So we mix insects coming out of the non-GM field, they breed with the ones that potentially could survive in a GM field, and when they mate, they dilute any potential resistance. We have strict planting windows, so we have to plant between the 1st of August and the 31st of December. You're not allowed to plant outside of that period. There's a length of time that it has to be in the ground, and if for any reason that goes over, you need risk management strategies. So if you can't get your crop harvested by the end of June, they will get you to do something the following season to minimise the risk that may occur with resistance. So yes, very, very strict rules, and we need to buy the seed. We can't just grow last year's seed as well. So we have to purchase new seed each year.
Great question. Next question. Do you think there's a shift to organic cotton by consumers? And do you think it's difficult to grow organic cotton?
Here in Australia, we would not be growing cotton without genetically engineered technology. And around the world, it's pretty much been the same. So organic cotton requires, it actually has a higher environmental footprint. So organic means non-synthetic, the use of non-synthetics, pesticides, non-synthetic fertilizers. It doesn't mean it doesn't get sprayed, however, and often some of those chemistries, which are old school chemistry or natural chemistry, can have a much higher toxicity load than the ones that we have available to us to use within the GM system. So the BT that's built into the crop means we generally don't need to spray. So as an industry across the last 20 years, it's reduced pesticide by 97%. If I was to grow an organic cotton crop, and I saw one yesterday in Theodore, I've just been away traveling with work. So they had done six pesticide sprays on their organic conventional cotton. So we actually have a much smaller environmental footprint with GM.
And another question, is cotton graded?
It certainly is. So just like wool, there's a couple of different factors that make fibres usable and spinnable. So they look at the length, the strength, the colour and the thickness. So each of those factors play a really important role on how your clothing will feel. So something like your pair of jeans, which surprisingly are probably the most expensive items in your wardrobe, actually use quite short fibres, quite thick and uneven fibres, just to give it that texture. But for example, the shirt that you've got on, Luciano, mm-hmm. it's probably a much longer fibre, probably a finer fibre, so it feels really soft to touch. Mm-hmm. So as you move into more higher-end quality clothing, you'll find the length, strength and the thickness plays a really important role. Oh, and the colour. The colour's important because, and we grow quite a creamy white cotton here, but if it was to be, if it was to rain in the last 2 weeks prior to harvest, that can impact the colour and it goes slightly grey and that changes the dyeability of a fibre.
Another question.
Yep.
How do you sell your cotton?
So farmers here in Australia have what's called cotton merchants, and they are the go-between. They're basically the people that we market our cotton to. So they purchase it and then they on-sell it for us. So generally our markets outside of Australia are places like China, Bangladesh, India, Vietnam, Japan. Australia actually grows really high quality cotton, and we're very well regarded. So it quite often goes into those people, those areas where they are on selling to higher markets. And it gets mixed and blended with other countries' cotton to lift their quality as well.
So I've got a couple of questions for you, Renee. What percentage of the cotton crop ends up overseas to be processed into products, and what percentage stays in Australia to get processed into products?
Yep. So as a crop, around 42 to 46% of what we produce is the lint, which goes into the yarn. The around 50% is fuzzy cottonseed, and around 2% is trash or leaf litter, grasshopper legs, you know, whatever is left in that that gets cleaned in the ginning process. So around 50%, 52% of our product stays here. So the fuzzy cottonseed is really high protein seed that gets fed, drought fed for cattle. It can be crushed and the oil is used in cooking products. It's one of the most popular cooking products that's used is cottonseed oil. And what's left is called the hull and the meal around the seed. And it's often crushed and used in animal feed pellets, such as chickens, pigs, sheep, any other animal that's going to be fed in palletized form, because it is such a high protein crop. So the other 42 to 46%, which is lint, will go offshore. Unfortunately, Australia has reduced the amount of manufacturing that's been occurring. And we did have a couple of small spinning and weaving mills. It's become really apparent during COVID the importance of manufacturing onshore. So we are hoping that the government, and there are lots of people really interested in getting manufacturing back onshore just for employment opportunities. It really secures up rural communities. We have someone over in Rockhampton, which is about 300 kilometres from me, that is looking at bringing back spinning and weaving, which would be fabulous for our community. So we're quite a mixed community here. There's mining, there's agriculture, there's railway, and there's meatworks as well. So it adds another opportunity for communities to be resilient during economic downturns by providing extra jobs. So I do hope that it's something that the government steps in and sort of really supports going forward into the future.
Fantastic. You mentioned a little bit about the technology that you use in the wide variety of cotton and chickpeas. What are some of the newer type of technologies that you're currently using or planning to use in the future?
Yeah, so we have a drone that was our purchase last year. So it's going to be used for monitoring dry spots in the field. Also, you can see the vegetation growth throughout a paddock. So if there is a potential hotspot for insects, you can run over the field and spot that particular area and go and check it out, whether it's could potentially be a disease area hotspot or whether there's an increased pest pressure. And it helps you identify, you know, certain problems in the field. So I'm really looking forward to using that technology when we are able to grow a crop. The other thing that's a really good factor with the drone is it has the potential to do beneficial insect releases. So if there is a hotspot of, for example, mealy bugs, I'm able to put in release. We have a lady beetle called the mealy bug destroyer. It's Cryptolemus. Solenopsis mealy bugs, but we have the Cryptolemus lady beetle that basically feeds on those particular insects. So we're able to identify those hotspots, release the insects into that particular spot, which would normally take quite a bit to walk through, and it will feed on those those pest insects. So that's pretty exciting technology. And it's been happening in the industry for quite a few years, but now it's a lot more accessible as technology reduces in cost. So, yeah, the sensor, the leaf sensor technology is really exciting because you're able to basically live manage, monitor the what the crop's doing in real time. So every 15 minutes, the information comes to your phone.
Wow, that's fantastic.
Where do you get the bugs from, the beneficials from, Renee?
Oh, so there's a couple of different companies within Australia that do it, but the closest one for me here is at Mundubbera, and they're Bugs for Bugs. Yeah, so there are a couple of entomologists that were really proactive in reducing chemical use on farm. And for me, that's a really important thing as an agronomist, is to try and reduce the pesticides that we use. I'm in a reef catchment here, so it's important that there's no nutrient loss, no pesticide movement off the farm. We really haven't used pesticides very much in the last few years at all. Maybe one for sucking pest insects such as murids. The problem with them is we can have lots of beneficials in the field, but they can move in very quickly on a storm front. So you may turn up one day, you've got half a murid per metre, or like one per 2 metres, and then a storm front will come through with no rain, but the wind brings them in. And the next day you could have up to 30. And that's, they have the potential to do a lot of economic damage very quickly overnight if they're not managed. So that's generally the only time that we will use pesticides, is if there's a sucking pest that there's nothing else. We've tried everything else in our toolbox of IPM management.
Renee, we conducted a survey of students last year to get their understanding and knowledge of primary industries, and we asked them questions about different careers and the like, and we asked them about what they knew about the role of an agronomist. And we discovered that very few students actually understood what that was about, and they couldn't identify with it. So could you sort of give me an idea of what does agronomy, but also what does an agronomist do?
Yep, sure. So, yeah, I've been lucky enough to do that for a very long time over my career. So we are basically wandering around fields and we are, I would call it, you're basically like a bit of a plant doctor. So you're, and it's very measured. So metrics are really important. So it's very science-based. We have insect thresholds. We measure and count an awful lot. So I walk around counting everything now because it comes a habit. So in so if, for example, I was to show up to my farm this morning, my role as an agronomist would be to walk into a field, and there's lots of observations. So I'm looking at the plants, and we measure, we do 10 metres at the top in a few different spots around the field. We're looking at the leaf. We're looking for any symptoms of discoloration or different spots. We're looking for insects. We're also looking at the soil, checking soil health. That can impact the growth of a plant. If there's good soil organic matter, that helps with the uptake of nutrients as well. And we're counting and measuring plant growth, fruit set, retention, which is there any loss on that plant? So has insects damaged that plant? So maybe leaf or fruiting positions have been removed. So it's a very visual counting sort of exercise, and recording all of that information. And then we have industry standard information that we can go back and say, well, if we've got this many insects, this many beneficials, all the fruit appears to be still there, then we can, it helps make agronomic decisions based on best practice from the scientists who give us those thresholds and those risk matrices on what could potentially happen in that field.
Fantastic. That's a great description. So if I wanted to be become an agronomist, if I had a real keen interest to be a plant doctor,
yes,
what do I need to do?
Well, there's lots of different options these days. So I've had summer students with me previously. So during the summer, an agronomist also requires bug checkers. And they're often young people on their school holidays or university holidays looking to earn some money during the summer. And it's fabulous money. It's around $25 an hour. And basically you learn to look at the field, and we teach you the skills required to count the numbers and be observational, looking for key areas of interest. A traditional route to get into agronomy would either be a diploma of ag science, advanced diploma, or a bachelor of science, or ag science in particular. But there are many agronomists around that have started straight from school and trained up under agronomist as a trainee without formal education as well. So pathways, there's lots of interacting pathways. So if you feel university does not suit you, you still have the ability to train your way up and do some learning skills along the way, upskilling.
Fantastic. Do we have any more questions?
I just thought one other thing when we were talking about is their classing of cotton. Probably the technology now that we use for traceability of where in a paddock it comes from, Renee?
Yeah, sure. I was going to mention too with the classing. So previously it was done visually. So we had cotton classers who would visually have, they'd have a sample box in front of them of all the different qualities. Now we have what's called HVI testing. And so basically a computer the fibre gets put through a computer and its sensor identifies the characteristics so that we're globally on an even playing field rather than humans detecting those characteristics. And there could be different interpretations of, say, for example, colour or thickness or something like that. So now we have this standardised system across the world. What was the second part of your question? Sorry, Jenny.
Oh, just the traceability. So
traceability.
When the gin receives the modules and how they trace that.
Yep, sure. So each of our fields, when we are picking cotton, we have a coded barcode for every single field so they know the variety. All the data that goes into that field is traced. So whether, you know, it's been irrigated, it's had pesticides used, the rate of fertilizer, basically every single input is recorded. So record keeping is very, very important for benchmarking and metric traceability. That data with the field, the variety, goes to the cotton gin, and they attach, as the cotton is going through the cotton gin, that particular metrics is going across it too. So it's all barcoded. So right down to the bale, they know whose farm it is, which field it's come out of, which variety it is. So if there is ever an issue such as contamination with, say, plastic, or could potentially have like sticky cotton from an insect. So if we have an incursion of silver leaf white fly, they leave a residue on the fibre. So that particular, if there's any issue, it can be traced right back to the farm and the field level. We also have some new technology where they can apply DNA coding so that when it leaves the farm, goes through the ginning, goes to the spinning and weaving mill to a yarn, that particular fibre can be traced as well. So for example, the UK can't say, oh, look at my lovely fabric that I've grown. They don't grow cotton in the UK. But we have seen it previously with items grown in China that were sold as Egyptian cotton. So now Australian cotton is completely traceable, and there's a transparent process all the way through. And that's really important for our supply chain in marketing high quality products too, because we don't want other people saying, look at my amazing product that we're growing and then selling it on Australian cotton as their own. I think that's very important going forward into the future too, is that full transparent traceability. It's, I think it's the way forward for us here in Australia. It just gives us, it enables our reputation to be very strong with that high quality and someone else not using our quality cotton.
Fantastic. Any other questions? We're just nearing the end of our session today.
I suppose the only other thing to mention with you talking about the way into the future, Renee, is that, you know, all that research that goes into our the seed in the first place is done in partnership with CSIRO. And I suppose globally, you know, Australian cotton technology and research now is being used globally because I think we are a little bit ahead of the pack with that research. And globally, we are supporting cotton farmers through the BCI program and other ways to make sure that, you know, our learning and discoveries are being discovered around the world.
Yeah, we're extremely lucky here in Australia. So the CSIRO lead our breeding team, and we have the highest quality seeds globally. So other countries are trying to learn from our plant breeders. Our industry funding, so every farmer that produces a bale puts dollars towards research, and then the government matches. So same with other agricultural industries. We have dollar for dollar matching of research, and it's enabled our industry to keep really strong, valuable research. And as an industry, innovation, technology, and science is what backs what we do. And that's probably the most important thing going forward. If there's not the evidence, if there's not the science and the data, it's a really good yarn, but you need those metrics to show that what you're doing is sustainable, economically valuable, and profitable for those farmers. It's very hard to be profitable, to be sustainable without profitability, and it's very hard to be profitable without science-backed decision-making tools in our toolbox. So having those scientists to back us on the agronomy, on the soil science, on the water science, it gives us the, what's the word I'm looking for? It's just a really strong position for us to make good decisions because we know we've got really quality people behind us enabling those things to work properly on our farm.
Fantastic. Well, unless there's any other questions, I'd like to thank Renee for her presentation today. It's really fascinating to learn more and more about cotton and chickpeas as well. And
I didn't have my presentation for cotton, but I had done that chickpea one previously. But they do line up because a lot of the agronomics is quite similar. The irrigation is very similar, and we use the tools regardless of what crop it is across the farm, because we know there's a lot of measurements behind it to show us what works and what doesn't work. And I had done that one up, I thought it was good to show you that one.
No, that's great. No, that's wonderful. Wonderful. And thanks to everyone else for joining us today. This session will be available as a recorded video, and we'll let everyone know when it's available so you can share it with the wider your class, if some of the teachers have logged on without their class, and we'll be able to share that. So so thanks again, Renee. Thanks for joining us today.
You're very welcome.
Thanks, Jenny. Thank you. for helping to organize today, and thanks everyone else for joining in today. Have a great National Ag Day.
Thank you.
Take care. That was great, Renee.
Thank you. I was going to say, have you logged everyone else out yet?
No, that's it's all good. I keep keep the Zoom session running all day. And